Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Computers are so complex these days. I'm sorry, so it took a few minutes to set up everything. Anyway, the title of my talk is Decompilers and Beyond. So I will talk about decompilers and more precisely about the decompiler I built. It's available since the last year, but it took me maybe 5 or more years to build it, because it was not that something simple. This is the outline of my presentation. First question, why do we need decompilers, and do we need them at all? Because a decompiler is a big thing, it's a very complex piece of software, and this complexity must be justified. Maybe we can go without decompilers and solve our problems without them. Then we'll discuss a typical decompiler design, how to build decompilers, and in my opinion, there are some misconceptions how to do it. And I will just show you how I do it. I build mine. And after that, of course, there will be some demos. There is no question of making a presentation without a demo. A live demo, and I hope that everything will go smoothly. And after that, we will be in position to discuss new tools and analysis that become available because of the decompiler. So because we have a decompiler and we can use it to build something bigger, more intelligent, more powerful on top of it. So that's our future as I see it. And after that, if you have any free time, hope so, there will be some questions and everything like that. So the first question about decompilers and if we need them at all. You all know that we use disassemblers to analyze binary code. And disassemblers are something quite simple. What they do, they take a binary file like PE file, MS-DOS executable, or just a stream of bytes, and they convert this stream of bytes into instructions. So it's very simple, one-to-one mapping. I could say that a nice, simple disassembler can be written maybe within 1 or 2 days. It's a very simple task. You create a table, and like, for example, 0x90 is mapped to no operation, nop, and so on, so on. So simple disassemblers, they just produce a listing with instructions. But if you worked a little bit with the real-world examples, real-world programs, you understand that this is usually not enough, and you need something bigger, something better, more powerful. I hope that you heard about IDPRO, and you know that IDPRO can annotate the listing. It has a very good navigation system. You know the difference between a good and bad disassembler, especially if you spend your time working with trying to analyze programs, and it's a very time-consuming activity. All disassemblers, they have one inherent problem. Their output stays very, very low level. It's just an assembler listing. So what you have is just listing of instructions. And these instructions are kind of very small. And you know you have this CPU registers, memory cells, addresses. But you, as analyst, you have to map these instructions into something high level. You have to give a meaning to these instructions. If you have a poop, if you have a push, then some instructions, and you have a pop, the same register, let's say. Based on my experience, I would say it looks like we are saving a register at the beginning and we are restoring at the end, but I have to do it. A disassembler will never show me that this is how we save a register and restore registers. So what we do, the analyst, he mentally maps assembly instructions into higher level abstractions and concepts. At the beginning, it's a very difficult task. And we can say that it's a very steep learning curve, and that's why anyone who can read assembly text is considered as being highly skilled specialist, which is true. But on the other hand, it becomes a very boring task after a while because you know all this stuff. And it's always the same, repeating. So in other words, I would say that the output is very boring and it's inhuman because humans are not very good with handling this repetitive code. Take this listing on the right. You see that we take a byte and we put it into the output buffer. We take another byte, we copy it, and so on, so on, so on. You read this, and after a while, you look at it and you say, okay, I understand that we copy bytes here. But the amount of text to analyze is very big. You have a temptation to skip this and to say, okay, we just copy bytes here. But are you sure that we copy bytes? We don't swap them? You cannot be sure unless you read. You have to read that the first byte is copied to the first position in the output buffer. The second byte is copied to the second byte in the to the second position, and so on. If you miss something, your analysis will be wrong. So at the same time, it's boring, but you must stay alert. You cannot say, okay, it's this, I collapse it into one line. By the way, it would be very nice to be able to collapse this into one line or even maybe two, three lines. By the way, in IDE you can do it, but you have to do it manually. And again, something that you lose your time. If you take another sample of these two instructions on the left, again, it's nothing, not rocket science. Look at this, you say, we take ECX, we take ECX multiplied by 2, 2 plus 1 makes 3. Okay, what do we do with that? What do we do with that? We put it into ESI, and after we multiply it by 2, 3 multiplied by 2 makes 6. Okay, so we take 6, we take ECX, multiply it by 6, and add EX. You see that it takes time. It's much better to have one line like this, and you are done. And a decompiler could generate a code like that for us. So my opinion is, and it was like this since the beginning, we need decompilers. They are very helpful. So especially today, when we have megabytes of code and the listings are so huge, so nobody, no human being can analyze everything, all instructions, everything understand. So all antivirus companies and everyone who works with reverse engineering seriously, they cannot analyze everything. So what they do, they just try to locate interesting parts of the code and analyze only that. But even that is difficult because even there you have a lot of code to analyze. So we need the decompiler, but the question is why we don't have any? We don't have any nice decompiler, before mine. I would say that because I am proud of the decompiler, how it works. The reason is because it's a very, very tough thing to do. First of all, you cannot build an ideal decompiler. If you want to have an ideal decompiler, something like you press a button and you have a nice everything, no. And my decompiler is not like this neither. So it's not ideal. We cannot build an ideal decompiler. I will show you some examples so you will see why. On the other hand, it's very customary to compare compilers and decompilers. It's said that compilers have these steps. They preprocess, they perform lexical analysis, syntax analysis, code generation, optimization. And decompilers have more or less the same steps. We can make it like this. Yes, this is true, that this comparison is correct, but it's very, very superficial. In fact, if you delve into the details, you will see that nothing matches anymore. And things are very, very different. Let me show you just two points. First of all, compilers are in a very privileged position. They have very strictly defined input language. Anything wrong, something suspicious, they just print an error message and stop. And their job is done. And if you are a programmer, you go and fix your source code. Compilers have a reasonable amount of information on all functions, variables, type information, everything. So they have plenty of information, they have very strictly input-defined input language, and they generate, because of that, correct output. The output must be correct, yes, but it may be ugly. Nobody cares about it. Who will ever read it but us, some geeks? On the other hand, machine code decompilers, we are talking about native code decompilers, are kind of impossible because the input is informal, and more than that, it's even just plain hostile, because sometimes your adversary is a human being that produces deliberately obfuscated code trying to make your life harder. Many decompilation problems are unsolved or proved to be unsolvable. So we are really in a hopeless situation. And the last point is that the output is examined in detail by a human being, and anything that annoys him will be reported either as a bug, either as a feature request, or anything like that. Could you do it? Could you implement it better? So the conclusion is that the robust compilers are just impossible. It's a reality, and I think that it's the truth. But on the other hand, okay, we cannot do this. What about trying to reach something to cover the most common cases and to create a tool that could handle at least, let's say, 90%, 80%, as much as we can? We know that the situation is hopeless, but we still try to handle it. I'm telling you how I was thinking about during all these years. I was first thinking, yes, it was a good idea. It's a good idea to have a decompiler. On the other hand, but I have this problem, I have that problem. What do we do? Do we implement it? I don't know. And while trying to build it, I was trying one approach, another approach, and I found out that in many cases, they are very simple, naive solutions, but unfortunately, they don't work. In fact, with binary analysis, it's always like that. I think that if you worked, and again, you know that anything that you can assume, any assumption can be proven wrong. Even if you say that we have a sequence of very nice instructions like move, add, and ending with a nice return, you say, okay, I'm looking at this code. This code does this, that. You may be proven wrong because there may be an exception, for example, a deliberate exception in the middle of the execution, and the execution goes somewhere else. So what you see on the screen does not correspond to the reality. It's not always the case. And if your adversary is a human being who writes a deliberately obfuscated code, then you can be sure that there can be something unexpected, new trick, anything like that. So it's kind of an arms race. But anyway, one thing is that if you have a human being as an adversary, another thing, let's say we don't have a human being as an adversary, so we make our task easier. We say that we will handle only compiler-generated code and nothing else. But even compiler-generated code poses lots of problems. Take function calls. When you look at the function call, you have to answer the following questions. You have to answer where this function expects its input registers, how it returns the result, if it spoils anything, registers, memory cells, if it changes stack pointer, and does it return to the caller or somewhere else. You have to answer all these questions. And when you analyze the code, you always answer them like in your head. But it's very hard, difficult, very, very difficult to do, thing to do, and even more difficult to formalize. Take the example on the left. We have a call, and it's indirect, so we don't know what we call. We have to do what we have. We have only 5 instructions here. How can you tell how many arguments this function expects and where they are? I cannot, because it's very difficult. I can't guess. What I can do, I can guess. And my educated guess, let's say, I am sure that there are 2 arguments on the stack, And about the third argument, is it there? No idea. I cannot tell. I can assume that this function accepts three arguments, but maybe not. Maybe only two. Maybe the rest was just generated by the compiler, and it happens like this. If you take the example on the right, again, it's very difficult to say. Apparently, it takes three arguments. They are all on the stack, but we don't know if it expects anything in the register. Your temptation would say, okay, no problems. What about solving this problem by looking at the called function? First of all, you don't have the called function all the time. You see that we have indirect calls here. But even if you have a direct call, it's not that simple. I don't have a specific example here, but it's not always possible to tell if a function uses, your first naive approach would say, okay, if the function uses a register, then it must be an input argument, right? But what if the register is saved on the stack at the beginning? Is it a use or not? Maybe it's just saved and it will be restored at the end. Maybe it will be restored in the middle of the function, so you cannot tell. Most of the cases you can solve, no problem. Most of the cases, let's say 99% of the function, you get it right. But one function in the output is wrong. And this function, unfortunately, gets called from 200 places. So your output is plain wrong. Another example about return values. The example on the left, what does it return? Usually we know that the return value is in EIX. And we say, okay, we know that EIX, but what about EDX? Do we return something there or not? Again, based on my experience, I would say no, it doesn't, because we subtract EDX from EX. It's highly unusual that the function returns both registers in this case. But maybe I'm wrong. To the left, the same problem. EDX, is it returned or not? We don't know. Well, based on the experience, we can say something, but it's mostly artificial intelligence stuff and things like that. Ah, yes, I have a slide about the input arguments. So the naive assumption that if a register is used, it must be an input argument, it's wrong, because it may be accessed, read, to save its value, and after you'll restore it at the end, to allocate stack frame. On the right, we have push ECX at the very beginning of the function. What happens here? Do we use ECX? Maybe not. Maybe we just allocate stack. As a human being, you also have this, all these problems, but you kind of solve them one way or another as soon as you see, encounter them. So it goes like this, and sometimes you see, okay, I made the wrong assumption, and you go back and you correct things, and so things work well. By the way, on the left, it's even more interesting example. You see that we use EDX. For formal, if you have a formal approach, you would say, okay, we have EDX, we use it. The high bits of EDX are used, but it's just an appearance. In reality, the function does not use EDX, the EDX register here. Indirect access is a problem because you have pointer aliases problem. You don't know the precise object boundaries. Again, just a small example. We take the value of a memory cell, ARC8, and we put it into ESI. And after we do that, we do this, we do that, and after we use ESI. Pedantic, strict approach would be to generate the code on the left. This way, we don't lose anything. We generate correct code. It's correct, but it's kind of ugly. It's not optimal. And any human being and many users already complain why we don't put ARC8 right into the call statement. like it's done on the right. You see that we have only two lines. Having two lines instead of three lines is much better. We have 30% of gain. Less code to read, less code to analyze, everything is better. But unfortunately, the decompiler cannot do it for you because the decompiler cannot prove that between the moment we move the value into the register and the moment we use the register, the ARC8 is not changed. It can prove about ESI, taking some assumptions, making some assumptions, but it cannot prove for the memory cell. Just impossible. Indirect jumps are also a problem. Okay, I think that I will skip this slide. You understand that we have to solve indirect jumps as well, but they are not easy to solve. And problems. I will stop here because there are too many of them. So everything here can be proven that just impossible to solve the problem in generic case. So we have a kind of hopeless situation. Yes and no. We can restrict ourselves to something very specific from at the beginning. Let's say we start with a simple and the quotes case. We'll handle only compiler generated code. So we don't have a hostile adversary human being. We'll handle only 32-bit code, and no floating point, no exceptions, nothing. Something simple, something basic. And we will have the following assumptions and the kind of basic ideas how to build the decompiler. First of all, the decompiler will be configurable. The user will be able to specify the calling conventions, the stack frame size, the memory model, and other stuff. The decompiler will use sound theoretical approach to all solvable problems. For example, data flow analysis on registers, we can prove things there. Because registers, they don't have indirect access. The biggest problem is indirect access. When you have pointers to somewhere, you don't know where it points to. Potentially, it can point to any place, and it spoils many things. For the cases we cannot prove anything, then we will use some heuristic approach. Indirect jumps, function prologue and epilogues, call arguments, the problems I showed you, we'll just make some rules that will work, let's say, 95% of the time. 5% of the time, they won't work. Okay, we know it in advance. That's why we say our decompiler will be interactive. So the user can go and say change something, specify something, so to kind of direct the decompiler and to change the output. Of course, we'll prefer to generate ugly but correct output rather than nice but incorrect code. And that's all, yes. And the user will be able to specify what to do in difficult cases or when the information is not available, the user will provide it. In fact, it's the same philosophy as with IDA. Why IDA is so powerful? Because IDA relies on you. You, as a human being, as an analyst, you can tell IDA that here it's code, you stupid tool, you don't understand this, you make it code here. And you gave names, nice names, you annotate the listing. The decompiler works exactly the same place, the same way. So if you expect something that you press a button and you have something, no, it will not work. For me, it was natural to have this the following architecture. So at the bottom, we have a disassembler. My choice was IDA Pro, of course. That reads the input file, it decodes instructions, and creates function for us. So the function division is done, which is good. Using IDA Pro is good here as well, because to separate functions from to create nice functions, it's, again, a very difficult task, and very difficult to solve in a general case. So that's why, again, the user can go and say, okay, this here, I have a function starting here, ending there. The next, on top of the assembler, will be a generator that will generate a microcode. The microcode is the name of the intermediate representation, intermediate language used by the decompiler. So we move away from the processor-specific stuff as soon as possible, and we switch to this microcode. And this step, this layer will also handle all platform-specific aspects. And the kernel is the core of the decompiler that will do everything that we need, do decompilation. And on top of this, there will be also add-ons like plugins, visualizers, other tools, and so on, so on, so on. And the decompiler would work using the following phases. So first of all, we generate microcode. At the same step, we also analyze the function prolog, switch instructions, verify that the function is defined correctly, that it's not like a stray move instruction, because this is not a good function. A good function must end with a return or a exit or something that makes sense. The next step is to optimize basic blocks one by one, simplify instructions and other stuff. The next step is to analyze everything globally. There we perform data flow analysis and delete dead code and other stuff. And then we allocate registers, allocate local variables. In fact, we replace registers by local variables. And after that, we have the remaining steps. We do something called structural analysis. We try to extract the control structures like while, if, switch, and other things that you use in high-level languages. And after that, we can generate code, pseudocode. I call it pseudocode because calling it C, C plus C would be, it's C in fact. But I call it pseudocode just to avoid any questions. Why does it recompile? Why doesn't it do this? And like, it's a pseudocode. I don't care about recompilation. My goal, as with IDA, is not to recompile things, but to make easy for you to understand things. So you look at the code and you understand things. The initial pseudocode that we generate is really bad. It's ugly. I will show you. So we need to transform it. And there are around 150 maybe different rules. Oh, no, less than that. I don't remember the exact number, but anyway, that make it better. Like kind of, these are code transformations that do not change anything. No semantic changes, nothing changes, but they still make better. And at the end, I do type analysis. By the way, this is something that I do. The other steps, you can say that microcode generation, you can find similar steps in other decompilers. But the type analysis, they always do it at the beginning, at the very early stages. I think that it's a very big misconception. The type analysis is possible only at the end, not at the beginning. Because only at the end you have enough information to derive type information, to build type equations and to solve them. And there's a final touch that to rename variables so they look nice and other stuff, that's the final step. I will just show some slides to you so you see how they look in my development system, in the final product, you don't have this microcode, everything is hidden for the moment because the reason is that I don't know if the microcode will stay the same. Maybe it will change. For the moment, it doesn't support floating point, for example. I have to add floating point, so it will change. Microcode as generated is huge because every instruction is translated into a sequence of micro instructions. Some instructions are skipped. For example, the first push ASI is skipped there. It belongs to the prolog, so we don't generate it. The first move is translated directly to move, but if you take the last instruction, like jump zero, you will see that it's the last, how many? Three instructions use this, the last three micro instructions correspond to jump zero, the last three. So you see, we take the code segment, we put it into a temporary register called seg, we put an offset, we put it into another temporary register, and after we say jump if zero flag, then we jump to this address. This is quite elaborate and quite difficult to read. Nobody reads this, so it immediately gets optimized. And you see that it shrinks in the size. It becomes smaller, but still we have some redundancy here and some unnecessary stuff like the initial microcode had all flags, processor flags, everything. In fact, let's take the overflow flag, OF. I don't think that it's used anywhere in the program. It's used very rarely. But we do generate it anyway, because just to be precise. But we cannot remove it right now because we cannot prove it at the basic block level. Maybe another basic block uses it. So what happens is that we optimize it further. We optimize first local optimization. And local optimization, this step will start already to lump instructions into big expressions. C's and second instruction. You see that we have already LDX, which means load from memory. And as a memory address, we have ECX plus 4 already. So we have microcode instructions maybe nested into each other. And this way, we naturally will get nice expressions at the end. We still have processor condition codes here, OF, CF, ZF, SF. I think that all of them will go, because we already have jump zero at the end, and nobody else will use these condition codes. And this is the task of the global optimization step. You see, after the global optimization step, it's very small now. The LDX register, the LDX instruction got propagated into the jump instruction. So we have very nice thing here. By the way, we cannot do it. Cannot do it here. Anyway, if you noticed, we started with something reasonable, like five instructions, seven instructions. We made it bloat into 100 instructions, and I don't know how many, bigger. And after we optimized it back into something smaller. So that's how it works. It becomes first very big, and after it shrinks size, and we get nice result at the end, very small. After that, we replace all registers and stack addresses by local variables. This is something I had to devise a special algorithm for that. After that, we will go and perform structural analysis. What we do here, the structural analysis, it takes the control graph. You see that it's very the control graph is very similar to the original graph view in IDA. And we have the control graph. And looking at the control graph as a human being, I can tell, okay, block number one, it passes execution either to block number two or block number three, depending on some condition. So it looks like if not a condition, then we execute number two, otherwise we don't do anything. So it's if condition, the if block. If you look at the block number six, it looks like a loop, we go back. So we repeat until the condition is satisfied. The structural analysis extracts this information from the graph and represents it as a tree, like this. And you see that we have if, then else, do, while, and all this information. It's encoded in this tree now. And this algorithm is quite robust. And I use, again, something special not seen in other decompilers. Special structural analysis algorithm. It's very robust. It can handle any graph. I even run it on random graphs. I was generating random graph and running this algorithm. So it, even if you have a really bad graph with many edges, it will generate all necessary go-tos. So you will still have an output. Maybe the output will be really difficult to read because you have too many edges. Or in other words, too many go-tos, but it still be possible. After that, we generate pseudocode based on this tree, and based on our pseudocode, we can say, for example, block number 12 here, on the lower right corner, it's a block. A block means that we have just a linear execution. So we have to generate code for the block number 10 and after two for the block number 11. I think that this block corresponds to the last three instructions, to the last three lines. We call a subroutine, we copy the result, and we return. The output is correct because we generate all cats that are necessary, but there are too many cats. It's almost unreadable. Again, this is not visible to anyone. The decompiler immediately applies transformation rules to that, and it generates something like that. This is almost readable. This is something that the decompiler can give you, but after that, you have to improve it. As the same way as with IDA. When you just take a listing, you should not take it as for given. You must improve it. Here, we have some casts, for example, this plus 4, and we have a cast here, put the double word, a pointer, and we dereference it. We take a value at that address. Why so complex? Why so awkward? The reason is that the decompiler does not know that this is a pointer. It thinks that it's just a normal integer, and by the rules of the C language, you cannot dereference an integer. That's why it puts a double word like this. A good type analysis, a very good type analysis, could deduce, looking at the code, say, okay, we have this plus 4. Apparently, at this plus 4, we have a pointer. Unfortunately, the type recovery algorithm that we use in right now, it's not very good, not good enough. It will be improved in the future, but for the moment, you have to do it yourself. For example, we have to tell that this, I think that it's a pointer to a structure. Usually, it's a pointer to a structure. V1 is a copy of this, so it must be the same thing. The same way in IDA, you go and say, I want to change the type of this. Type of this or that or V1 or anything. And you can change things. You can, by just saying that this is a pointer, the output, you can modify the output this way. You can add comments, you can rename variables, functions, you can do everything you want. Please note that the initial assembly was too long to be displayed on one slide, so that's why I did not even display it. But the final result is quite simple. I think that it's better now to switch to some demos and show you how it works. Because a live demo is always better than slides. Okay, we have a function here. It takes one argument, as we see. And after we take... we put this argument, we take plus 8, we put it into EDX, EDX plus 4, all that stuff. You see that you have to analyze this. Okay, I'm lazy. I just ask the decompiler to generate an output for me. I press tab, and that's what I have. In general, decompilation is very fast. It's almost instantaneous. So unless in some cases it can take really huge time if you have... function, let's say 200 kilobytes of code, then it will take time. Yeah, it may take even an hour or even more longer. Well, that's how it works. But I'm not satisfied with the output. You see that we have E1 plus 4 plus 8, all that stuff. It's not good. Again, why it happened? Because the decompiler does not know that A1 is a pointer. Okay, I will tell it. I will right click and say, please create, there are many ways of doing it. I can say, I want to set the type manually. I can convert it. I can convert to a structure pointer. In this case, I am really lazy. I will just ask, please create a new structure type for me, like this. This is what is proposed by the decompiler. It looked at the code and found that there are references like this. I just accept it. Still not that good. I think that I better go another way. I will show you. The argument that we are having, it's a pointer to a graph that has some nodes, as you see here. And each node has an array of successors and predecessors, and it has also some attributes, and each attribute has an ID, has a name, a type, value. So you see, it's quite standard stuff. What I will do, I will explain all this to the decompiler. It's very easy to do. First of all, I will tell Ida, ask Ida to parse the file that I have, parse the C header file. This is not something that comes from the decompiler. This is something that basic functionality that exists in Ida since long time. The compilation is successful. So I have all my types ready. And now I say that A1, I know the type. It's not a pointer to struct A1. It's a pointer to graph underscore T. So it's a pointer. I put star. And I press OK. And that's it. I think that this is the best you can have. I can, of course, I can rename this. I can call graph like this. So I have, is it visible enough? Let me make the font bigger. I think that the font is too small. Is it better like this? So instead of this code, you have to decipher anyway. You have only this code. Yes, you have to explain things first. You have to explain the types. But as soon as you do, you have very nice code. Another sample. What is this? Okay, we have a function that takes some arguments and calls string compare many times, calls, makes some comparisons, you see, jump zero many times, and after it calls print, and that's it. Okay, instead of looking at this code, I just press tab, and that's what I have. In fact, the whole function is one if statement. If this, 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 or that, or this, and so on, the result is zero, otherwise, the result is one. Apparently, here we just check the, some, we perform some checks, and we do this or that. By the way, I can now replace things. I can say, this is, I know that it is, let's say, okay, I will just rename it, okay. And after I will say that this zero is false, and this is true, and these numbers, okay, I don't like them, I change them, for example, into hexadecimal. Well, hexadecimal is not good. I will change it to characters. Ah, characters look nice. You see, you do the same things as with Ida. And without doing these things, the output looks ugly. And I think that this is, I will call it magic. And I can add a comment saying failed. See that the comments are here. So the compiler is interactive, fully interactive, as you might suspect. Another sample, another example, what we do here. We create something, okay, I will press, oh, it's, here we have a loop, we have to do this, something. Anyway, I will just press tab. Okay. Again, have a nice function, and you see that the compiler could recognize the for statement, the for loop. Apparently here we take, okay, what do we do here? We take a malloc, we allocate some size, okay, we take some memory, and after we initialize this with, some values starting 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and up to size. And the second, what we do here, we swap them. Okay. So looking at this code is much easier to read than this code. It's out of question that you can read. This code is also readable, but you spend much more time. You have to say, okay, this push, what is this? Okay, we just save a register. The decompiler hides all this information and just shows you nice result. Okay, do I have anything else to show? Okay, here we have a sequence of calls. I see that we call init sub many times. Okay, just press it. Yeah, I like this better. So we have a nice, almost a table. So we initialize files, segments, functions, registers, and so on. Easy to read again. What else here, main? For me, at least, maybe because I spent so much time with C code, you spent a lot of time with assembly code. Maybe that's why you would prefer this, especially you if you never programmed in C. But if you program in C, you see that the difference is just very big. This is for the demo, and I think that we can switch to the slides. So the obvious benefits of the compiler is that we save time. We look at the code. Yes, you have to make sure that currently, looking at the code, you must make sure that, for example, this short circuit takes three arguments. But since it's very easy to switch between the assembly and pseudocode, it's very easy to verify. If you suspect that something is wrong because maybe it's guessed wrongly, then you can just press tabulation and see, okay, you verify it visually like this. So it saves time. It eliminates routine tasks, so you get less bored, you stay more alert and attentive. And also it makes the source code recovery easier. And here I have I know that there are some legitimate reasons to recover source code, but I see another obvious use of source code recovery to steal the other's code, and this is something I'm totally against. That's why, this is one of the reasons why I say no. The output is not meant to be recompilable. I'm sorry, it's to analyze code, it's to understand code, not to recover source code. Of course, there are many things to do in the decompiler, and there will be always new things to do. And there are also tools that we could build on the top of the decompiler, like we can go into the next level. Currently, we don't even try to recover the structure information to rebuild objects. This is something that could be done, and this will be this way we'll move closer to the application domain. We could also rename variables. We could give them some more meaningful name. For the moment, right now, we just have names like V1, V2, V3, and so it's your responsibility to go and rename them. One obvious tool is a vulnerability scanner based on the decompiler that would use the data flow analysis results and try to do something. I just have not enough time. I would do it myself, but so that's why if someone wants to write a vulnerability scanner on the top of the decompiler, why not? Right now, the API, it's already open. The decompiler has an API, so you can write your plugins, play with them, and everything like that. But the internal stuff, the microcode, is for the moment, it's hidden. It's not available, accessible from your plugins. By the way, the compiler could be also used for binary translation, to port code from one processor to another processor. You have code for Intel, you port it to ARM. From ARM to, why not? In principle, it's doable. Well, so right now we have a nice solid base to build on, and I hope that it will continue. So the core is processor independent already. Right now we support only x86, and ARM will be next, and there will be also floating point instructions and other stuff. Batch mode is supported. But there may be other tools as well that you could think of and I could think of. I just tried to give you some ideas, things that on these slides, they don't exist. First of all, it's not, I wouldn't call it a vulnerability scanner, just something that verifies the programs that could find something like, for example, if the tool proves that a function may return a null, but at the call side, the return value is not compared against null, then we have a potential problem. I don't say that it's a real problem, but we have something wrong here. The same applies to the input values. It can be, what about also performing taint analysis, finding insecure code patterns? It's much easier to find these patterns in the decompiled code because you have all this minor stuff like the register names and other stuff already disappeared. You have high-level code. It's easier to write pattern matching there. What about finding uninitialized variables and other things? So a tool that would verify binary code. And all these things, they are potential bugs, or maybe they are potential even vulnerabilities. Why not? On the other hand, the decompiler could be also used to improve the assembly. So the results of the decompilation could be moved, copied back to the disassembly listing and make it easy to read. Or we just could make it possible to hover the mouse over a register, and the plugin would show its possible values, the locations where it's defined or it's used and other stuff. So we could highlight definitions or uses of the current register in two different colors and many other ideas. Well, anyway, I think that I will not stop on these things in detail. I think that you can come up with your own ideas as well. All this stuff, I personally am very, very interested in all this stuff. Because doing this will help you, will make your life much, much easier. Just you see that, okay, this value is red, this register is colored red. It means that we could not find where it's initialized, it's uninitialized register, how can it be? And okay, you have something to look at. Well, I already discussed this stuff that we need a better type recovery. And I think that again, with other many problems, this is an end story and we cannot make it a perfect solution immediately. So we will start with something simple and you may have your own plugins that import data type information into the decompiler. Also, this decompiler could be used to perform some statistical analysis, to cluster functions depending on their type, on their structural properties, and other stuff. So I don't know. I just tried to give you some ideas, but I think that. Binary code comparison, yeah, just one idea, why not? By the way, I was doing it from time to time when Microsoft released a patch, just checked like this. It doesn't work all the time because when the code is moved around, then it becomes difficult. But most of the time, it gives you good results and shows you which function is changed. Well, anyway, I think that all this stuff is very interesting, but we have to implement it, the only thing. But since we have a nice base, and I'll try to keep it as open as possible, I mean that with API, with the SDK, so you can write your own plugins and improve the analysis and all that stuff, so we have many things to do, and I think that we are in position to implement most of the things. Again, it won't be perfect, it won't be ideal, but it will be something that we can do. Well, that's all. I maybe rushed at the end a little bit just to make sure that I don't go too far. Anyway, so thank you for your attention, and if you have any questions, feel free to ask.
Any questions from the floor?
Yeah.
Can you talk about how you handle C++ code versus C code?
Right now, the decompiler can handle, in fact, any code. It can be C++, C, Fortran, assembly with some assumptions that you have nice functions there and they return nicely and all that stuff. it's not compiler dependent. It doesn't use anything like pattern matching that if you have this, then it's this. But everything is mapped to C. So even if the initial language was Fortran, it will be mapped to C. C++ will be mapped to C as well. And the decompiler is capable of handling passing arguments by not only by reference, but by value, structures by value as well. This was quite difficult to handle, but the decompiler handles them okay, let's say. And you have a C output. And I would say to decompile into C++, what you should do, you should take this output, write a plugin that would leverage it, that would move it to C++. Because C++ maps into C very nicely. And in fact, everything that you have C++, let's say almost everything, can be represented in C without big problems. Of course, you have inline functions, templates, and all this information. I'm sorry, it's lost. And again, you have to reverse this manually. But C++ is one of the possible directions, let's say, as a plugin. I don't consider this as a part of the main core engine. It's good enough. It's better to have a nice core engine that is produces nice C code, and after that, to have an addition, a plugin, that will convert C into C++ using this type information and all that stuff. Yeah, why not? Does it answer your question? Anyone else?
Well, all right, thank you very much.
Thank you.